to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us. Even when we were dead in sin, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen.
Thank you. Of others for whom you may be offering prayers. So I invite you to come forward at this time for laying on of hands for me. I lay my hands on you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, beseeching him to uphold you and strengthen you with the healing power of this gift of love. Amen. Nancy, I lay my hands on you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, beseeching you to uphold you and strengthen you with the healing power of this gift of love. Amen.
Dear Lord in heaven, we pray that you heal our pastor. Bless him and be with him in all that he does. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Dust praise you? Will it tell of your faithfulness? Hear, O Lord, and be gracious to me. O Lord, be my helper. You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have taken off my sackcloth and clothed me with joy, so that my soul may praise you and not be silent. O Lord, my God, I will give thanks to you forever. Here ends the reading.
Fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him, and a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. The Holy Gospel of the Lord.
That was a grace.
Oh, there's more. I'm sorry. I thought it was a blank back. Now, there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately, her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you? How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha cum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. I have a comment to make. How is no one going to know this? They're going to hide the little girl for the rest of her life? No, people will know. But I think Jesus is saying to those who have been up in the room with him with the little girl, it is not your job to go out and proclaim who I am and what I've done. The acts themselves actually bear enough witness to who Jesus is. And that's true of everything that he's done here in this reading. The Holy Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Now you must have thought we picked these readings for the fifth Sunday, right? They're the lectionary series, folks. They were picked years and years and years and years ago. Church, no music, light sandwiches, and wedding cake. But the Polish folks knew how to party for a wedding. They always rented a big hall and had a bar, and it was either a cash bar or an open bar. Lots of people gathered from the community to celebrate the marriage of the bride and groom, and they always had a live polka band. And so I remember my mother teaching me how to do the polka. My knees don't hold up to it well anymore, but I still know how and have danced the polka lots of times. And in fact, if you're from the Midwest and you're a polka person, you can at least keep rhythm to a lot of the Mexican polkas you hear in the community blaring out of car windows. The rhythms are the same. The music is quite different, but it would be the same dance that you could do to that. That was my first memory of dancing. I have lots of wonderful memories of dancing with my bride. In high school, after every basketball game, after every football game, there was a dance at Oriole Hall. And so we would go from the games, lots of times walking in the winter, to get down to the dance, and we would spend the evening dancing after those games. We had a wonderful time. That was the first place I met my wife's parents, was after one of those dances. I was a little taken back. Do you remember what things looked like that night, Melody? I do. Her dad pulled up in a big Cadillac Coupe de Ville. We drove Fords and Chevys at our house. And her mother had on a mink jacket. I don't think anybody in my family ever owned one or even thought about owning one. But that was their kind of style. They'd been out for the evening, and I have to tell you, as a high school student who started driving a delivery van the day I got my driver's license, I got to drive those Cadillacs a lot. And to this day, I would love to have one of those great big old Cadillacs. But mostly this is about the dancing, where we had a lot of fun dancing together. Slow dances, fast dances, we kind of did them all. And then we got married and we had a Swedish wedding reception. Sandwiches and cake in the parish hall. No dancing there. But then we went to Ann Arbor, Michigan to my first call. We didn't do any dancing, I think, during seminary either, that I recall. But we went to Ann Arbor, and Ann Arbor had a dance club. And members of our congregation, the Wolchens, went to that dance club and took us. I don't remember, it was more than once, but we went and were able to dance then as well. Haven't done a lot of it out here, we've been too busy with kids. The 8 children, but we still really enjoy music, and we enjoy the rhythm of music, and we enjoy the beat that is a part of that that we would dance to. So we've done a lot of dancing over our lifetimes. But there are other kinds of dances that we do. We do a dance with our spouse that's not a musical dance. It's a part of our relationship with our spouse. And we spend time with them and we cherish each other as a part of that relationship. And it is a big part of who we are, that dance with our partner or spouse. We dance with our children. No, not the kind of dances they dance today, good Lord. I don't know that any of my boys dance particularly. I think maybe at the prom this year they may have danced. But a dance with your children's different because you're trying to guide them. You're trying to lead them in the dance they're growing up with in their lives. And that's a really important dance that we have. There's also a dance that we do at church. It is a dance with the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sustainer of life, who lives in, with, and around all the parts of who we are. So we also dance here with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Coming to communion is a kind of dance in our lives. There's a rhythm to it about coming to receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ, the presence of it in the bread and wine of Holy Communion, and the promise of that dance. There are lots of sayings about dance. I'm not going to state them here. But dance is intimate. Dance is one of the most intimate things we do in our lives. Our dance with our partners and spouses, our dance with our children, our dance here at church with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. All of these things are a part of a significant relationship that we can call a dance. Now, we dance with other things too. Those were, I hope, all the positive things. But we dance also in our lives with emotional struggles. And sometimes that dance is better than it is at other times. We dance with economy issues. Is there going to be enough to make it to the next check? Or is retirement going to be enough? We do our dances around those things as well. This morning I got in the van. I have a dance with our big van right now. We've been dancing with that thing for about a year and a half, keeping it running. This morning I got in it, turned the key, and went, boop! I thought, I just put a new battery in it last year. So I turned the key back, and I thought, well, I wonder if it's going to run. Because I'm sure it'll be another $1,000 at the Ford garage if I have to take it in. So really gently and wishfully, I turned the key, and it started right up. Now we're going to see what happens after church. So I kind of had a dance with the van this morning about wondering what was going on with it. As you can tell in my life, I have a dance with food. I really love food. Of almost all kinds. I mean, I love liver and onions. It's one of my favorite things. You know, I'm not real fond of sushi, but I don't mind a tuna sushi, and octopus is very interesting because it's the tentacles that they make the sushi out of. And I keep telling my boys, and those suckers get stuck to the roof of your mouth while you're... No, they don't really. But you think they might. So I have kind of a dance with food, and I suspect we all have that. For some of us, it's to eat enough. Oh, Lord, I'd like that to be the case. For some of us, we eat too much. Some of us have a dance with chocolate. Anybody here got a dance with chocolate in their life? Really? Come on. There's hardly any time we don't have chocolate in our home. So yeah, those are other kinds of dances that we do. And sometimes dances take us away from our relationship with Christ. We hear this gospel reading from Mark today about all the people who had this interpersonal relationship with Christ, a kind of dance. One of them was a very distant dance, the woman with the hemorrhage. She just felt she could not confront him and ask him personally, and thought, if I just touch the hem of his robe, that'll be enough. That's one kind of dance we do with Christ. Not expecting Christ in all the fullness of his grace to be a part of our lives, but coming to Christ to do that dance when we have a special need in our lives. And then there are those more full dances with Christ. The dance of a person of faith who comes to Christ on the knees of their heart, asking for Christ's healing as we did today, and giving thanks to God for his inbreaking love and the way in which Christ surrounds our lives every day. But there are also dances of non-belief. Imagine the leader of the synagogue who had to ask and ask and ask and ask, and I would suspect humiliate himself in front of the other Jews who were there. But he was desperate in his life to have an answer because he had heard what Christ could do. And finally he came to have that dance with Christ at the most disastrous time he could have ever thought of in his life, the death of his daughter. And Jesus responded. Jesus chose to fulfill that dance with that leader of the synagogue and to bring healing to his daughter and to give her new life. She's only sleeping. I don't think anybody understood that. And there's no It's no wonder that people ridiculed him when he said it, because others knew how to assess death. And yet he went and she was raised from the dead. And you notice, Christ was a good Lutheran. The first thing he said was to give her food. We know how to feed each other. And in this case, it was more than just the food of the wholeness of God's grace and the healing and new life of Jesus Christ. It was that she needed to be sustained physically too at that time. We share in dances like those in our lives with Christ. We you know, arguments and frustration are a kind of dance too. And there are certain points in our lives where we get frustrated and angry and we step away from our relationship with Christ. But the Spirit never stops coming after us to dance with us again, to bring us back, to help us understand what our faith is really all about. That it is an opportunity to be in this intimate relationship with our Savior that we so desperately need at those times when we pull back. I am confident that each one of us can think of a time when we walked away from our relationship with Christ. Maybe it was brief. Maybe it was over some anger of some kind. Maybe it was grief over a loss or death in our family or our friends. It's hard to know what those times are that pull us away, that we dance with kind of brokenness and have this desperate need for healing that comes to us through Christ. There is a song I want to share with you today. Debbie has it recorded. It is about the relationship of Christ with us in the dance of life. For all the times when we are not with him, and for the one time that is it is most important for us to be restored to him. I hope you enjoy it. It's a popular song. You probably have already heard it.
Yeah.
Christ is your name on all of his dance card. Be sure you save at least the last one for him. In Christ's name, amen. Gracious Lord, we thank you for always being ready to dance with us in our lives. Help us not to ignore you and to go do other dances away from you. We pray that your Spirit will call us back and help us to remember that at the end of all things for us, you are still there offering to dance with us in eternal life. Help bless us in such a way in this life that we never forget the bounty of your love for us. Hear us, O God.
Mercy is great.
Gracious Lord, we pray for Debbie's friend Ellen in Michigan. She's been in and out of the hospital. She's having lots of health issues. Now they've discovered that perhaps the antibiotic she's on, she is allergic to, and that's been causing a lot of her health decline. We pray for you to wrap her and enfold her with your healing care, that you bless her with comfort and peace, and grant the doctors your guidance and wisdom as they treat her. Hear us, O God. Gracious Lord, we give you thanks that the 33 dogs that were rescued in Rio Rico this past week, who thankfully were all in pretty good shape and had been well cared for, but whose owners could no longer keep them because of a move, that people have stepped up through this rescue organization that Joanna and Kelly work with, and those dogs have been adopted out. We thank you for the hearts and movement of the people who did those adoptions, who offered their homes and their lives. And we pray that we'll be more mindful of the other parts of your creation, like our dogs and cats and pets, that need the love we have to give them. Hear us, O God.
Mercy is great.
Gracious Lord, we pray for your speed for Joanna and Kelly and patients. They're headed up to Minnesota to see their family up there. Keep them in your safe care as they travel. Let this be a time of rejoicing and reunion for them. And of course, Lord, bring them home safely to their home here in the community and to their church home here in America. Hear us, O God.
Mercy is great.
Gracious Lord, we pray for Annette's boyfriend, Steve. He's been through some surgery again to deal with prostate cancer. We pray that his recovery is quick and full, and that the treatments the doctors have chosen to use are successful. We pray for Annette, for her shoulder and back, hips and knees, that you'll be with her to offer her and give her freedom from pain through the care she receives, and to lay your hands on her to help relieve that pain she suffers with so much. And we pray for Annette and Steve as they travel to California this next week to see Steve's children and grandchildren. Keep them safe in their journeys. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Gracious Lord, we pray for our nieces. Our niece, Lisa, is married to Tony, and his brother seems to be critically ill. His family is coming in to see him at this point, so it doesn't sound very good. We pray that you'll be with Tony and his family and with Lisa and the kids as they go through this period of uncertainty and perhaps coming grief over the loss of Tony's brother. Keep them all in your care. Bring them comfort and strength and courage in this difficult time. Hear us, O God. Gracious Lord, we pray for Roger. He's applied for a job at a mining company here in Tucson. We pray that if this is right for him and it is your will, that he will indeed get that job. We also pray for Roger because he's been working outside so much in all this heat. We pray that you'll keep him safe, well hydrated, and that you'll help him find relief in a new job that won't require outside work so much. Hear us, O God. Gracious Lord, we pray for everybody who suffers with this heat, who just can't take the heat and the humidity. It's difficult probably for almost all of us, Lord. But we pray especially for our daughter Melissa and our daughter Rachel, who really struggle with the high heat and humidity of the summer here in the desert. Be with them and with pets that we care for, helping us to be mindful that they need to be brought in out of the heat and the humidity so that they also can be comfortable and healthy. Hear us, O God. Gracious Lord, we pray for our brother in Christ, Paul, who's in prison. There are some changes coming for him about maybe a slightly early release to a halfway house or some other situation where he will no longer be in prison. We pray that you'll be with Paul as he awaits the outcome of the decisions for those people who have the power to make those choices for his life. Hear us, O God. Gracious Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to pray to you. Our hearts are heavy for the brokenness of this world. We have division within our own country. We watch the Ukraine and Russia at war. We watch Israel and Lebanon and the Palestinians in the Gaza Strip and the West Bank going at one another constantly, hoping that in death and destruction there will be peace. We all know that doesn't usually work very well. Everybody involved comes away broken, needing to be healed, needing to be comforted, needing to find a new kind and source of peace in their lives. We pray for peace in our world, that you will be a part of that you will help us speak peace to people we meet. Because of the love of Christ in our lives, that is a power that resides in each one of us. Hold us in your care as we work perhaps only one person at a time to make a difference in your world. Hear us, O God. Gracious Lord, we give you thanks for the rain of the monsoon. We pray for some more. But not too much, Lord. But we pray that you'll keep your desert well watered this summer so that the plants and animals who survive in the wild are able to make it through these hot summer months to the cooler weather of the autumn and winter. And bless us all. We thank you for that gift of rain and pray that it will be an opportunity for us to take a cool breath in the midst of the summer storm, to remember the power of your love for your whole creation. Hear us, O God. All these things we pray in the name of your Son and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you. Please greet one another with the peace of the Lord this morning. Let's prepare our hearts and minds to receive the sacrament of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It is Christ's holy meal for all who accept him as Lord and Savior. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples to eat, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray the prayer our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please come and receive the sacrament of Jesus Christ.
I'm
body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace, now and forever. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.